you everyone for coming. It's my great pleasure to welcome you here tonight on behalf of the Brooklyn Museum and the Elizabeth A. Sackler Center for Feminist Art, where Wangechi Mutu, A Fantastic Journey, has been entrancing audiences for over a month. As organizing curator for the center's presentation, it has been an honor to work with Wangechi, her dedicated studio team, the originating curator Trevor Schumacher, and the National Museum of Art on this beautiful exhibition. For tonight, I'd also like to thank our special guests, our manager of adult programming, Elizabeth Callahan, and Dr. Elizabeth Sackler. It is a further joy and privilege to introduce tonight's program and share with all of you. Around 7 or 8 months ago, when Wangechi and I first talked about programming and were discussing this evening, I can honestly say that Nora Chipaumire and Adrienne were the first two names out of her mouth. We'd been considering themes in her work that might be drawn out through programming and performance and performativity as strands not only in her videos and durational collaborations, but also in her collages and installations and sculptures was something that she wanted to talk about. Well, I guess she was already deep into a collaboration with Nora that will be at the Smithsonian, and Nora's choreographic work, Miriam, had recently appeared at BAM. And we realized as well that our exhibition would overlap with Performa, which is the performance art biennial that Adrienne is associate curator of. So really, it would have been impossible to think of a better constellation of speakers who could join Wangechi for this conversation. And so we're thrilled that this dream was able to become a reality and that you are all sitting here tonight. So thank you. I personally can't wait to hear what happens, so I'm going to keep introductions brief. Born in Mutare, Zimbabwe, and currently living in New York City, Nora Chipaumire has been challenging stereotypes of Africa and the black performing body, art, and aesthetics for the past decade. She has studied dance in many parts of the world, including Africa, Cuba, Jamaica, and the U.S. A graduate of the University of Zimbabwe's Law School, Chipaumire holds an MA in dance and an MFA in choreography and performance from Mills College, and has been an adjunct faculty member at Arizona State University Tempe, Bennington College, the University of Minnesota Minneapolis, and Barnard College. A featured performer with the dance company Urban Bushwomen from 2003 to 2008, she served as their associate artistic director from 2007 to 2008. She's been presenting her own choreographic work, some of which she'll discuss in a moment, nationally, internationally, and on film, receiving numerous awards, including an Albert Award in the Arts, a United States Artist Ford Fellowship, and 2 New York Dance and Performance Bessie Awards. Her work has been supported by the MAP Fund, the Jerome Foundation, NYFA Build, and the National Endowment for the Arts, among others. Our moderator tonight, Adrienne Edwards, is a curator, scholar, and writer of performance with a focus on artists of the African diaspora and the Global South. As mentioned before, she's associate curator for Performa Institute, which has been filling our cities and calendars this month with what seems like an endless array of exciting events. She's also a curator at large for Third Streaming. A PhD candidate in performance studies at NYU, where she is a Corrigan doctoral fellow, her research interpolates visual art, performance, experimental dance, critical race theory, feminist theory, and post-structuralist philosophy. Adrienne has written on the works of Iona Rozelle Brown, Lorraine Grady, O'Grady, Bill T. Jones, Gregory McComa, Tracy Rose, and McLean Thomas, and contributed to numerous exhibition catalogs, including Clifford Owen's anthology for MoMA PS1, 4 for the Studio Museum in Harlem, and most recently, Wangechi Mutu for the Museum of Contemporary Art, Sydney. And finally, the artist inspiring tonight's event, Wangechi Mutu is a Brooklyn-based artist whose multimedia practice encompassing collage, sculpture, installation, video, and performance has garnered her recognition as one of the foremost contemporary artists working today. Born in Nairobi, Kenya, she came to New York to study art, receiving her BFA from Cooper Union and her MFA from Yale in 2000. A recipient of the Deutsche Bank First Artist of the Year Award in 2010, as well as the Brooklyn Museum's 2013 Artist of the Year Award, Wangechi has most recently participated in the International Center of Photography's Triennial, the 5th Moscow Biennale, the Paris Triennial, Intense Proximity, curated by Okwe and Weiser, as well as the Kochi Muziris Biennial, the first in India. In the past year alone, she has had solo exhibitions at institutions including the Museum of Contemporary Art Australia, the National Museum of Art at Duke University, North Carolina, and the Staatliche Kunsthalle Baden-Baden, Germany. Wangechi's work is in public collections, including the Museum of Modern Art in New York, the Whitney Museum of American Art, and the Studio Museum in Harlem. Please help me welcome our special distinguished guest.
Thank you to Saisha Grayson and also Elizabeth Callahan for bringing us together and to the Brooklyn Museum overall. When I was preparing for tonight, one of the things I was thinking about was, what is it that brings these two women together? And there's some obvious points of collision. They're women, they're African, they're artists, they're cosmopolitan. But then I think perhaps less obvious to you now, but perhaps what we can really explore tonight are their aesthetics of fragmentation, their use of repetition, exhaustion, in terms of their approach to the black female body and black female subjectivity. And then also the ways in which they mine the archive, typically through interventions in modernism, anthropology, ethnography, philosophy, literature. I could go on. But more often, because I know these women personally, is also just the force of them and their will and their desire and their sort of insistent drive to experimentation. Nora shows us the ways in which dance is immensely visual and reveals our own ways of looking and our perception of what bodies like ours can do. And Wangechi illumines the fundamental antagonisms of being in art with her disturbing beauty and bringing an astute rigor to her gestures and objects. And I'm interested in these junctures and intersections between them and their aesthetics and their sensibilities and ideologies. And the meta question for me is really, where do they see themselves in one another's work? And they actually, you should know, have been in dialogue for some time now, but are presently undertaking a project, part of Artists in Dialogues at the Smithsonian Institution's Museum of African Art, which will premiere in a project in 2015. So where we're gonna go from here is that Wangechi will start and she'll talk a little bit and show some work, Nora will do the same, and then we'll have a conversation and then a Q&A, and we'll be done.
I'm thrilled to be here with friends and peers and people who I have great private conversations with, and now we get to talk in front of you. So, but I'm not going to talk in length about these images. I'm going to let them speak for themselves, and then we'll discuss things that relate to our work and our interest in each other. So, in case you can't see, at the bottom left it says Kikuyu Women, circa 1900, and these are the people I come from. But I particularly like this image because, first of all, it's a photograph and it's a picture of the very last remaining moments before the British had completely transformed Kenya into what it is. So these are my women, the women of my nation, before British colonialism had taken over. This is a work that I did called Cleaning Earth. It's actually a video performance piece. So I enact this labor of cleaning this patch of earth, which is, in actual fact, a very badly maintained garden in my backyard. And I wanted to think about painting and composition and kind of idealize this figure that I was representing. But obviously, this woman is working. The black female body is in full-on labor, work mode, tirelessly trying to clean the earth, a Sisyphean activity, which obviously made the woman as dirty as the ground that she's cleaning, but also didn't do much to clean the soil.
and eventually I end up in the forefront. So I'm always in this sort of composition where you can see me in the forefront, but I've moved all the way from the back of the garden to the front. She sees dance as an exuberant work done 2012, and it's a moment when I feel my life and the circumstances that surround me entail a dance that's sort of private but full of openness and, in a way, happiness, I guess. And I try to dance like one does when they're not being watched, especially one who's not a professional dancer. and that's, she sees dance, and it's reflecting and projected on a reflective surface. So there's a lot of back and forth. Image is both playing itself in the audience can see itself in the curtain. There's a lot of glimmering and twinkling and femininity, and as I said, exuberance is the best word for this moment. And at the same time, there's also this lurking, these eyes watching her, and they're synced in different ways, so they're sort of very awkward. Nguva is another performance video work. This is all Nguva, this is her out in the world. Press play now, thank you.
that's it for now. I think Nora's going to show some images. Should I?
I think perhaps we should just go right ahead to the last heifer. Perhaps what I can say as a way to begin talking about my own work is that I am the subject. I am my own subject. I am very much invested in discovering myself. As opposed to just being a dancer and an object. So the process of finding myself leads me to always be working with my own body, and also primarily invested in working with myself alone as a solo voice. The fact that I am a woman is a huge fascination even to myself. And so I think the last heifer came, heifer is also an insult, right? So it came from a place too of trying to embrace something about being female that isn't, there's always something a little bit funky about it. So I wanted to claim this this whole idea when somebody says, you're heifer, and I'm like, yes. Well, now look at this heifer. I'm gonna be the last heifer you ever say heifer to. And I'm gonna say it like I mean it, with bells ringing. So, and also embracing something about, you know, cows. Celebrating. So I actually think there's something about celebrating my gender, celebrating my own discovery of being woman, accepting what that means, the responsibility of that. But also it is always, I believe, laced with the fact that I am born and raised in Zimbabwe and I am my mother's daughter. And having left Zimbabwe somehow allowed me to walk into a space where I could question what that was, what that meant. And so using my body allows me to be in a constant place of questioning and discovering. I really don't know what the answer is, but I enjoy absolutely posing the question and trying to discover it viscerally and in a space of, for instance, this piece, I think, was perhaps half an hour. I like to do works that develop, unfold over time. So short works aren't necessarily my forte. Anything that goes beyond an hour, I feel like I'm in my comfort zone with lengthy monologues, self-portraits. In a way, they're also self-portraits. In a way, they're also monologues. They're debates. I'm having this dialogues with myself first, but in this space of time, space, and force that we call dance. So that's, you know, the discovering of myself as a female human being who comes from a particular place is something that I find, continue to find, to find that it provides me material. And also discovering this female human body outside of my own cultural context is something that also I find very rich. And in a way, I have been given, I feel lucky, I have been given an opportunity to speak in a way that I probably could not in my mother's house.
I really like these two presentations of your work because at a dinner party, maybe now several weeks ago, Nora, you said, whenever I'm working with dancers, I always ask them, well, what are you doing now, right? Like, let's start with where you are. And I think that these things really show the ways in which you start with what you are, what you know. And Wangechi, it's something interesting thinking about this show, Fantastic Journey, because what many people don't realize is that performance and also installation was a part of your work from the very beginning. So I'm very curious as to why you had the inclination to work in multiple disciplines. What is it that working with performance in particular, whether it's videos or otherwise, does for you? What does it bring to the work? And Nora, I wanted to ask that of you because Right Raya, the piece that you just premiered as part of the Crossing the Line Festival, takes place, your dance takes place in a sculptural installation, there's a use of text. So I'm interested for you as someone who describes yourself as a dancer, as a choreographer, what does that do for you? How does that make the work different? So maybe we can go.
For me, I feel the main thing is that I felt like I had no choice. I came to art through a rejection of the other forms that I loved, which was, I actually acted and sang in Kenya. And I found it so difficult to continue in that rut because I didn't have, first of all, the support system because my parents and my peers didn't think it was something that was viable. And then at some point, I just got discouraged because I was told enough times that, you know, we dutty women go on stage, you know, get off stage, you know, get into something that's going to take you into a serious adult life. And so I shrank back into the studio in a way. I basically chose a form where I could close the door and do what I wanted to do. And I guess the coming out for me was leaving my home country and arriving in a place where I had no connections, I was anonymous, I was unsafe, I was fearless, I was disconnected. And that in and of itself forced me to have to come up with a self that was new, that was what I wanted to really be. And that thing, in a way, is a performance. It's a reconstruction of yourself, the way you'd rather have been around the people who you came from. And I think, so I approached it from that direction. I think there was always translation. There was always explaining of my accent, explaining of where I'm from, explaining where Kenya is, explaining how to say my name. All of these things had a lot of, this self-creation. But then I think what also happened to me is I was unfortunate I didn't have great painting teachers. So I also opted for sculpture and video and all these other forms that allowed me to piece together some of the forms that I related to as contemporary African art forms, where things are integrated. So music, dance, the visual are less segmented. Painting was about painting, and I love working in two dimensions, but I couldn't start up the conversation in those classes that was meaningful to my own story. So I, again, ran towards sculpture, ran towards, these
isolated performances were quite private. I had a video camera and myself often, or my brother filming and myself, and that was it. And then I actually studied sculpture for my master's. I didn't actually go to Yale for painting. I get thrown into painting all the time, and I always have to say, I know nothing about painting, but I'm here to talk in this painting department. So even these two-dimensional works that are in the exhibition, one of the peculiar things about them for me is that they're not really paintings. You know, I'm a drawer who's ended up, because I have dexterity and a little bit sinister, I cut a lot. and that's where I've ended up. You know, there's something about my performance that has gone into this other place where I create characters, but and these characters are many layers of things that both I've experienced as a young woman, I've seen, I've wanted to become, I am, and then this other practice, which is creating these illusionary worlds.
And it all comes together. I think you see it particularly in the video performances, for sure. Yeah. It's like I always say, you're like, you witness the becoming. You're becoming what people identify as the cyborgs of your collages, right? And the play aspect of that, which is so fun.
My plexiglass box. Actually, you know, being with Wangechi, it's kind of clear. I'm a choreographer, I'm a mover. That you know, my first language is physical. You know, even though I do really truly firmly believe that dance is a visual form as well. I mean, clearly you look at it and it's moving. And there are some choreographers who are masters at making it almost filmic in a way. And you can think of how Merce Cunningham would paint, you know. And so I think in some ways they are really much very related forms. I also do believe that coming from Africa that the separation of dance from a visual, you know, those two categories aren't necessarily real. There is no dance performance in most parts of Africa that would not include all the elements that you would maybe put aside as visual elements in of themselves. So I have always worked with that principle that, you know, I want to create a visceral visual image as well as a kinesthetic atmosphere. So with this most recent work that I am currently in the midst of, The Right Riot, I wanted to put myself on display as if a performer is never on display. But kind of really highlight the fact that performers and performance are really consumable ideas, consumable entities. And I think a great deal of that thinking has come out of the conversations that we've been having over the past year or so. You know,
the notion of display.
Yes.
Vitrine and all of these sort of objectifying kind of models that we've found ourselves thinking about so much in very different ways, but they come together, they overlap in our conversations.
Right. And also the idea that in the, or at least what seems to really separate what Wangechi does and what I do is the sense that at the end of the day you can walk away with an object that you can buy. That is, you know, a visual object, and you place it on your wall. So I'm really intrigued with this. What do you walk away with from a dance performance? You know, so I was really going for this idea of making myself an object. inside of this box. And this box with an accompanying text is my black African body. And it's part of some private ownership. It's owned by somebody. So we tried to really, myself and the team that I worked with, embrace some of the things in the white box that come from those white boxes, those museums, and sort of hijack them for a black box, which is where the dance lives in a black box, and really go for that idea. What if I was this object? What if I was, for lack of a better way to put it, one of these women in Wangechi's paintings that comes alive, all skin and pin up and no apology, So that's sort of currently a really intriguing place of, what do you hold? What is tangible about dance?
I think a lot of institutions are trying to sort that out now.
I think for me that what's enviable about Nora's form, and in fact that's what I think, our conversations keep expanding in these different directions, but one of the things for me is the shape-shifting that is possible in your form is so magnetic and intriguing and powerful. And in some ways I guess came through in the animation, but I feel like there's so many things that are moving in time in my imagination, and when I place them in this collage, I calcify them, I petrify them, I basically hold them in one little moment, one frame. But I think performance is powerful. From that perspective, it is slippery. In many ways, that's part of what is so important about, I think, removing yourself from that place of comfort, because there's movement and there's that move. In that movement is discovery of a new self, and also the refusal to stay still also prevents people from saying what they think you are. You get to define yourself in every given second, which I think is really, I don't know how you do it, but kind of unbelievable and cool,
Yeah, I think in some ways part of what has been exciting about our dialogue is that I see movement in your work. And I can go inside of a piece and then make it my own and just go somewhere else with it. And so, and that's not typical of many, objects that you see stuck on a wall. They just kind of, oh, okay. But I do remember the first time I saw a Wangechi Mutu picture. I think it was in a fashion magazine. And of course I was like, what? What is that? She's African? It was absolutely scary, but I couldn't look away. And then the dare, the provocation, the movement, the kinesthetic feel that I was getting from the image, I just wanted to jump into that picture. I don't really remember which one it was, but it was one of the women. It was just so exciting to be able to see. I think for me, what I was repulsed, but I was also drawn in. I was completely there's a word for it. It's no good African girl could do this. And I think as as my understanding of the images has sort of grown, and I also started to understand that I'm also doing kind of like crazy things, and identifying with the movement, the color, the life, they just seem alive, you know. So I guess the, you know, it's equal envy on both sides. How do you go home with an object that seems alive, you know, like that's what I want to do. I want people to leave my performances with something, you know, that has completely been imprinted into their psyches.
It's funny you used the word psyche, because I was thinking about both of you and thought the ways in which your work is really about activating kind of psychic caves, like these mental places that, in a weird way, it's almost uncanny, because you realize, you know, there's this theory of visuality that which you see and recognize is because you already know it, right? It's like you can't recognize that which you haven't already somehow been introduced to. So it's about touching this place that you may or not even realize is already there. So you recognize.
Yeah, I think we recognize that in each other's. Yeah. There's this kind of, you know, DNA connection, but also, and I mean that formally and artistically, DNA. We're not sisters, such, in that way. But I think one of the things I also realized is I knew something about the way I had been saying things, was evading description, and when I saw Nora's work, the first time at 251 Arts, I'm forgetting the name of the piece.
Lines Were Wrong.
Yeah, exactly. I think that's the first time I felt like, okay, this is that place that we come from. And you were mixing that issue that you brought up, this dominant colonial language that has been sitting on us for the last whatever 100 or so years, brought with it a kind of a puritanical whiting out of things, and an education that I think we both have done well with, and in fact, you know, trained in, and all this nonsense. And I remember seeing in your work this really naughty movement, and this very very trained, and particular the intelligent cheekiness that was about saying, you know, we were comfortable with our bodies, you know, we've been comfortable with our bodies, now we've adopted this thing and we have to reconfigure our bodies so we can pretend that we weren't comfortable before. And I'll tell you what, we were comfortable, and you kept doing these things, and I was like, yes! You know, throw your skirt in the air and do all those things that in Catholic school, in all these sort of kind of Britishized Anglo situations, we were told no, and our parents, in order to get us to this whatever stage where we were educated, said no. And I think, so I saw that rebelliousness in there, but it was a particular feminine and female and gender bendery, yummy kind of rebellion that I thought, I need to talk to her. I really need to talk. And that is, I think, what's powerful is that I think there are these parallel languages that have been going on in both our works, and we hadn't really realized it until we finally met. So, but I think, yeah.
It's interesting, because I've already gotten the 5-minute mark before we go to Q&A. I'm going to take the privilege of the moderator and ask one question that I really have wanted to ask you guys. Because I was reading, as I often do, and I'm obsessed with her, Zora Neale Hurston, right? She seems to always illuminate things. And I was sitting here with my two African sisters and needed another Southern Black American, which I am, to kind of get to be on par with these two. And I was reading her Characteristics of Negro Expression, which was written in 1934. And maybe later on we can talk about it if there's time. But if not, I just want to mark it to say, I wanted to ask you two, When you arrive to the United States and this concept of blackness, how did you as Africans negotiate this within an American context? In other words, what does that concept mean to you? Do you feel that it's irrelevant? Do you feel that it's meaningful? Do you feel that it's useful? Where do you negotiate that as a paradigm? And I'm turning to Nora because
I have issues.
Yeah. Exactly.
Can I read a quote?
Yeah, go ahead.
From Popel. To be black today is a choice that has to be made and remade like a cake, or a bed, or a contract, or a promise, or a solar system. Race was invented by less blacks to create a power relation that served their own interests. In the most obvious sense, less blacks can sometimes be people who are referred to or refer to themselves as white. In our way of thinking, less blacks are people who, if you ask them whether they would prefer to be black or less black, would say less black. Since the 17th century, blacks have been about the project of making their own meanings around blackness. Over time, this project has become much more public. Some blacks wanted to create meanings around blackness that would protect it from less blacks. And I just love this quote, and you want to take the floor?
I think at some point, there were two sort of defining moments in my time in America. The first one was somebody on the street called me a nigger, said, "Get out of the way, nigger." And I was like, "I'm not a nigger, you fool, I'm an African." I was so upset. I couldn't quite get over it that idiot couldn't tell the difference. But then the second moment was I've always danced in women's companies, and I have to say, African American women have embraced me and made me a sister and have taught me a great deal about how to survive. So one of those sisters said to me, "But you're not black, you're African." nigger, not black, you're African, I had come to America, all pan-Africanist, thinking all blacks were created equal and that it was the same. And so, having my difference being sort of pointed out, or my blackness being lumped into a bigger blackness, I think there have been issues that have really provoked me and challenged me and helped me realize that there was actually a beauty in accepting the fact that African is not the same as being black,
So what's the distinction?
That I am my culture, mm-hmm. the way I've been brought up, the way I live, the way I comport myself, is African. There's no color to that. Mm-hmm. Being black is a real aesthetic. So I think that idea of a reinvention and all, there is an aesthetic, there is and in dance there is really something called black dance, unfortunately, which clearly means there's something called white dance, but there's real clear understanding of what that looks like. People assuming that just because I'm black, I'm doing black dance, or just because I'm African, I'm doing African dance. But I find those two spaces of really interesting. They lead me towards a margin which is really charged and a potential to always disrupt what the assumptions are about what Africa or what African is or what black is. Well, clearly I'm black and African, and I can separate those two or be those two at the same time.
I think one of the things about coming to the US from the continent, from Kenya, from Africa for me, was that we had a very clear idea of what the visitor is named, you know. So people who are Mzungu are just coming to travel, to look around. And in fact, now the term has become, it's a Kiswahili term, it has become like a very, again, it states, it's still, it's become a racial term. It means a white person, but it actually doesn't mean a white person. It means somebody who's running around almost aimlessly, because I think the original Mzungu was this traveler, this explorer, this missionary, just kind of wandering with no family and no connection, and then eventually, of course, you realize that they had these very particular ideas. But so coming to the States for me was an awakening, a racial awakening. I had assumed that I knew about race. I didn't know anything. Because being raised in a majority black nation, you don't walk around going, you're black, I'm black, are you black, I'm black, are you black, I'm black, I'm black, I'm black, I'm black, I'm black. You don't, you just don't, because everybody is identifiable in very specific, nuanced ways. And in fact, you can tell a Kamba from a Luo, from a Kikuyu, you know, you can tell these very specific nations that are pre-British, pre-colonial, pre-all of the European stuff. And if you're African, you can tell a Sudanese person from Somali, from South Africa. And those are the terms that I came with, and I think Nora came with too. So to come to a place where, without being warned, you're told you're one of them, was difficult, confusing, and your reaction, my reaction, let me speak for myself, was to be confused, to be slightly resentful, to go, what is that? And then to immediately try to figure out, what am I being called and why? You know, and I remember this one woman who worked at Parsons School of Design. I think she was assistant of the director. Sharon is a Southern woman, and she said, I said, I'm like, Sharon, what is it? What is this race? What is this black thing? She said, child, let me tell you, when you see it, you're never gonna stop seeing it. And I was like, oh no. Because I knew there was a moment where I would get it and that would be it. It would never be the same again. And eventually you realize, you know, this is not the city, the state where people are burning crosses necessarily, or, you know, people aren't tied in ropes. So race is very nuanced. Racism is quite nuanced. From a day-to-day basis, you cannot identify and go, that's a racial incident right there. I mean, certainly there are those, but it's even more dangerous is probably a heavy word, but I feel that, because I couldn't tell. And then I realized why I couldn't tell. I realized that there was these codes, these things that were happening under the current, and that those things were what I needed to figure out and to learn and to blacken up, you know, grow up. And I started, honestly, by learning my Caribbean and you know, the diaspora, the history of Haiti, and the kind of the syncretic practices that you have in some of these spaces were what made me understand how race operates. Because I guess I couldn't sink myself right in the States initially, and then I sort of looked at Brazil and then move closer and closer and kind of learn more about what
U.S. Racial history comes out of and what really I was dealing with. So I think, you know, I always say I was racialized in America. I grew into my identity as a black person here, which is an odd thing to do at the age of 21, 22, because you've got this other mind that's very clearly formed and aware of another history and another confidence. And a lot of Africans, in fact, choose not to identify with blackness, with black history, because it's heavy and it's real, you know? And you know what? Unfortunately, it's a choice for them, not a choice for everybody. So, you know, I'm thinking about Lupita Nyong'o's interview last night on NPR and how well she spoke about her role as Patsy in 12 Years a Slave. But I'm also thinking about how the film is acted by non-Americans. How well
directed.
You know, even the evil plantation owner, he's not American either. And so there's this interesting thing about being able to perform
blackness
and perform whiteness better than those who've actually had to live with it and create it and reject it and remake it, you know. And it's so close that maybe an outsider does it better. You know, on screen, that is. But if we go back in history, our independence as African nations are linked in every which way you want to think about it to the civil rights, to what was going on here, to Pan-Africanism in the US. The freedom fighters of the black nation in America informed our leaders, and the languages went back and forth, but we wouldn't have figured out, you know, a lot of what we needed to figure out. Marcus Garvey's documents were read by the Mau Mau, by the Kenyan freedom fighters, and they understood, oh my God, this is what we need to do. And so this brotherhood, this sisterhood, this problematic family that has been torn apart is still trying to figure itself out, and I think we're doing it through our work, but I think it's still difficult because no one wants to be told what they are.
Yeah, I think, you know, it comes out of this history of struggle, and from my perspective, at least within the United States, black Americans needing to define, right, that space was not only presented to them, but then needing to actually coalesce for a whole series of reasons. And that I'm very interested in how people interact with that space, and as someone who writes about black aesthetics, you know, like the already inherent antagonism and challenge with this project that tends to conflate identity. And I think that when you are an artist or an individual who is all about pushing bounds, there is a resting with that. So I think it becomes about how do we avoid that sedimentation, that kind of narrowing vision, and allow individual aspects to come to the fore, but while still being very clear about the real social and political challenges that inform lived experience and aesthetics. With that, maybe we can go to a Q&A.
I just want to first express appreciation for the dialogue I've seen both of your work. My question is going to be more about the show upstairs from Wangechi, but I do want to first say I appreciate your last comments, because after all, this country was founded on the slavery of African people, and the system we live under, capitalism, was founded on the slavery of people all over the world, and that's the financial foundation of the system. And I guess I should say, My name is Andy Z, and I'm the spokesperson for Revolution Books, and we're about getting rid of this entire system that gives rise to the objectification of women and the subjugation of people around the world. I wanted to ask Wangechi, and going through the show, there was a little piece in a glass case that had a little line written on the bottom that said, that struck me quite deeply. It said, in your mind, you envision yourself a butterfly, but you still find yourself on your knees. And you wrote that in small print on the bottom of the drawing. I said, wow, in a certain sense, I felt that encompassed a lot of the show because these images are soaring in their beauty, and they're also fierce and full of rage of Medusas coming out of people's heads. And yet, when you get close to them, you see these sort of horrific images of the objectification of women, as well as fantastic animals and other things. And I just thought that there was a metaphor there for the, and I don't want to put my words in your intention, but I thought there was a metaphor for the work as a whole and sort of where we live. And I know just briefly, Revolution Books, this is what we're about, is how do we actually get up off our knees? And we have a way to do that, a new understanding of communism developing, not making, but we're trying to get people up off their knees where they really can be the butterflies in their souls. And so I just, but what did you mean by this? And am I just reading all my shit into it? Or is this really where, you know, you're living? I thought
yes,
it was
you're reading all your shit into it, but it's good, because it's perfect. it's good to read your shit into things. That's what it's about, you know? That's what it's about. You know, you're pointing out definitely things I was thinking about when I'm working in my sketchbooks, issues that have to do with the very private colonizations and the shackles within us, you know, and what holds us down, and what we like to act and pose like we are versus what really is going on in our lives, you know. But for me, it was also, I've had a peculiar journey in terms of my immigration status. And so for a long time, I dealt with this issue through imagery and metaphor, and this notion of being able to travel was a burden and a dream for me for a number of years. I forgot to say that cutting was actually done at the border of the US and Mexico, so I was also interested in border issues and the notion of what a border is, and this line that is cut by nations, by patriarchy, by capitalism, and how fake it is, and how if you go up in the sky you don't see these borders. In fact, they mean so little, but they hurt so much, you know, they prevent so many things from happening. And so this cutting was done at the border. I was cutting the border, but I was cutting to enact this violence and to enact the beauty of work, which is what I did for the years that I wasn't able to travel. So I was thinking about that idea, the notion of being free in my mind and then not being able to move. But also, in many ways, in many regards, I was also talking about the larger kind of story that I think, you know, we are all caught in, you know, we who are trying to kind of denounce some of these, you know, institutions and I guess oppressive, conglomerates. You know, we are powerful and powerless all at the same time, trying and working at things together to get us out of this place, because we all know it's not a good place we're in, and we're better than we understand more than. So it's that kind of thing. But my sketchbooks are very therapeutic. And so a lot of things that happen in my sketchbooks are stream of consciousness. I kind of, just like a writer would sort of just let the words flow. I do it, those drawings, with the hope that what will come out will tell me what I need, because I can see my damage and my issues and my obsessions and my line, you know, my line also tells me how I'm feeling, how I strike the page with a pen, and the strength, the elegance, the lack of, the confidence. I see things in my line that tell me what I need to work on.
That was a question there. Did she walk out?
Hi, thank you both for this conversation. It's incredibly refreshing and empowering to hear your own processes as artists. So you both have spoken a lot about your African identities, as well as how your identities were shaped and your art kind of developed here in the States. So my question is brief. I'm curious to know if you have taken and shared your arts back home on the continent, and in particular the places you come from, and what that experience has been like for you.
Yes, Africa is really important to me, and I make it a point to spend as much time as I can working there, either teaching, choreographing, and infrequently performing. But when I have performed, it's been phenomenal. A great deal of concern about why my hair is so short. Because there's also a tradition where short hair is only worn because there's bereavement. Somebody has died. And so, you know, this, you know, kind of concern about that. There's always a great deal of concern about the actual gestures I am doing. In my work, because lo and behold, in most parts that I have performed on the east coast of Africa, Kenya, Nairobi, in Tanzania, on Zanzibar, on the west, in Senegal, or in Congo, people actually get the codes, they get what I'm saying. Most people here, they're sort of oblivious. They may kind of get a hint of something is afoot, but they don't really know what it means exactly. But you know, opening your crotch is just cussing somebody. And people get that, like, immediately. So there's much ado about why I'm doing that. So I really find
why do you do that?
I like to cuss. I like to do all the things that I couldn't do. I mean, you have to understand that I grew up in a very, very normal household where you could not say a bad word to anybody ever. And so the oppression of that, I couldn't wait to be able to cut. So working there by any means necessary is absolutely vital to me. It gives me life, gives me energy, keeps me real, because also most Africans really, really understand the body. So no matter how abstract the work is, they get it. It's good or it's bad, you know. So and this lack of politeness, which I think most performers would really appreciate. You know, that you get an instant understanding of whether your work is going anywhere or not.
Hi, thank you guys for being so lovely and encouraging me to continue making my own artwork. My question has to do with your definition of culture when you were defining your Africanness. So I wrote it down, so I make sure I say everything I want to say. You identify Africanness with the culture you were raised in. So what would you have to say for the African American children who are already 3 or 4 generations in that can't identify with the culture of their own? I know it's a heavy question, but I was thinking about it when you were speaking.
I'm not sure I understand the question.
But yeah, I totally disagree. But I think that African American children you're talking about are being raised into a culture. There is a culture called African American, because there is an American culture. Mm-hmm. why deny that?
No, it's not denying that. No, not at all. In offense, I'm just saying, like, okay, I don't think I'm wording this correctly. It's in no way to be an offense, but you two women come from Africa, so you can identify with the cultural upbringing that you feel pride in. And I just feel like, as a second-generation Puerto Rican American, I have a sense of culture as well, and I, in a sense, feel a little lost with that. Do you understand? Am I offending?
No, I would just say that I think that there are endless reverberations. I mean, I could sit here and go through Zora's characteristics of Negro expression, and you would see, you should check it out, but it literally, really, so much of this work and writing has already been done. And not to mention, you know, in terms of tracing what's there in terms of Black American culture, and we can just take the Black and push it to the side and say American culture, right? It's like, they're inherently intertwined, right? They're not distinct things. So, Robin Kelly gave this talk in February where we were talking about surrealism, right? And because I'm obsessed with Black, so I called it Black Surrealism. And he literally traced, starting with the blues, right? He didn't even need to go back to the sort of canonical art historical history of surrealism in Paris. He said, well, let's start with the blues.
Either I blow it up or I work out what it is about these kind of images of women that bothers me, that has marginalized them, this beautiful body that creates continuously, that is always changing, that is always producing. Why is it so vilified that the nakedness has to fall into pornography and the trenches, and that its clothedness is what we prefer to see if it's a particular shape, a particular color, a particular this. So I draw out of these very sometimes cheap, easily thrown out and in and away references, and then from there I go larger if I need to, and I create these larger drawings that I use as the template, the backdrop of the larger collages. And by that point, the hand is moving in a different way, because I'm not doing this, I'm doing this, and you know, that movement, in actual fact, affects the way those bodies look. And that elongation that you see is not frivolous. It comes out of the love of making that mark longer and that body encapsulate and hold the eye in itself. So that's where I go to when I make these larger works. You know, my performance envy and my dance envy comes out of that, because I want to see these things be what I perhaps wanted to be, but also I know that they can move, that they are free, that they are, and free in that way that they are in their own worlds. And then I start to create a narrative out of what's in front of me, as opposed to what I originally started off with. And that is where I start to act out and persuade this body to accept all of these different bits and pieces that are not anything to do with the natural body. So I use collage almost like a paintbrush, but I also use it to antagonize. I use it to draw the viewer in the eye, to make tons of misconceptions clear, like, why do we have this fascination with facial features in this particular way? Why do we have this fascination with proportion, with melanin, with all these things come alive in that. I remove melanin in order to talk about it. I exaggerate features in order to draw people who are easily drawn in the wrong, weird direction out there. You know, people are so fascinated by full lips, big lips, that's an African lip. Why? And why do you, why has that become, for some reason now, the most coveted kind of mouth after it's been for so long vilified? So all that happens, and then eventually I glue them down, or I get help gluing them down. But that's the way I go. And then with my sculpture, it's about kind of, creating an object that is interesting to make. You know, because I think one of it is one of the things I like to think about when I'm watching someone make an artwork or when I'm making an artwork is that I'm enjoying, I get lost in it. I get lost in your work, I get lost in work that I really appreciate and bring my own shit to it and enter, you know. And so with sculpture, I create something that I love. I love the movement. I like the way it makes my hands feel. I'm a tactile person. I like to, you know, my people are farmer people. Maybe that's what it is. So we you know, we mold the earth and we create food and we, you know. So I like that kind of work. And I physically do things. I don't try to work it all out in my mind first. I let my mind be my entire body. And then I create these sculptures, and if I need help, I have, you know, my wonderful studio assistants help me make things in multiples. So that's why the footballs, is 300 of them. I originally made 30 of them. So that's my process in a nutshell. What about you?
Well, the question was about filmmaking, though, right?
No, I just said I love
filmmaking. Oh, okay. Well, excuse me. It's just mysterious. It is with you the whole time, and it is changing every single minute, you know. So I think that the process of living, of being inside of my body daily, with its aches and pains and the whole range of the physical thing, is in itself a very informative, you know, process. How do you feel when somebody touches you? You know, what does longing look like, feel like? You know, what does hunger, what is joy, you know? You know, I try to just work from being in my body, being alive, as opposed to a dancer must present something. Oh, you know, or it must look a certain way. That bored me instantly. You know, as I entered the sort of professional dance milieu, I was instantly bored to tears by, you know, just a line that's supposed to hang there and not say anything back to me. So, you know, I'm grappling with myself. And I have to say, endlessly fascinated. And as the body gets older and experiences accumulate, there is just so much. There is just so much to explore and to understand. What is a band? What is, you know, how low can you go? And what does that mean, you know? How high can you go? I'm just interested in very simple being here now. And you inhale air, you bring space inside. You know, we're all breathing the same air. So in a way, we're sharing so, you know, so much. You know, what does that mean? I know it kind of sounds California and stuff. But, but it's kind of... It's those are the things that matter to me now. You know, how can you embody humanity being alive while performing? You know, everything else is kind of irrelevant and bores me to tears. That's my process.
So I'm being told that we have to wrap up.
Oh.
But I see all of these people with questions. So I have, again, privilege of moderating. And you were just anyway. What I'm going to suggest is that you each say your question, and that these ladies decide what they're going to respond to. So you go. You start, and then we'll go down here.
How could making art facilitate equity?
Okay, you go.
So I wanted to ask about your work. I've been studying, I'm a British-born Nigerian, now studying in New York, and I've been studying the idea of utopias a lot and how different groups in the African diaspora have created their own utopias. I found it very difficult to find a utopia that accurately addressed and solved or provided a solution for Black female identity. So I wondered, in your work, how do you create new imaginaries, new spaces, which reflect your multiple identities and the multiple thematic resonances of your work?
Okay, so she's asking about utopia, you know.
Mine's more of a comment, but I don't know where that I would stand in that right now.
Can you make it?
Yeah,
so thinking about making it a question, and I'm gonna say you go.
Me?
Yeah, what's your question?
My question has a lot to do with, you talked about reconstructing and finding an identity that that allows you to sort of like, you know, be who you are. And what I find with a lot of artists, African artists, especially women, that we're only able to be ourselves outside of Africa. And so much more than just having our art in galleries all over the world, are we actually able to reconstruct ourselves again and live and actually be able to survive in Africa, considering all the plights that women go through in Africa, especially being an artist.
Beautiful.
I just wanted to ask, as artists, like, do you think it's important to find a medium of what you do as an artist, or how do you start from something as having artistic tendencies to actually finding a medium? Do you think it's important to find a medium, or do you think, how do you start from just thinking of something to creating something?
Okay, tell us.
Can you guys talk about the ways that you might identify or not identify with queer and transgender aesthetics?
Very good. I like, again, privilege as a moderator. I want that answer.
My question sort of relates to his and fascination with being female, being a woman. I'm wondering if working with the body as your subject, and also in some cases as your medium, if that's helped confirm gender identity, mess with gender identity, if it's been at all helpful, or it's been more problematic, and if you move more easily in your body through the world having made your art. Thanks.
Sorry, last one.
Okay, my question is about something related to language and communication, and how you navigate both having to speak in a language of power and at the same time contesting that. And I had a question about sanity and insanity and how that kind of plays out within this notion of the language that you bring to your art. I don't know if that makes sense.
You meant sanity, sanity the storm.
Madness.
Sanity, insanity. God, I heard
so I'm going to do a mashup.
Okay. What do you want to take?
Nora, what do you want to take?
I wish I could take all of them because they're all really fascinating. And but if I had to just take one, I think the reality of that, that I became the artist that I am outside of Africa is kind of like really close to my heart. Because that's something that I am wanting to change. You know, I want the acceptance at home. I need that. And so I think the work that I'm making daily is going back home. You know. Also have to say that most artists are themselves outside of their own homes, too. So, and I think that answers the queer question too. I think that answers the utopian question too. I think that answers the insanity question too. Yeah.
the perfect place to end.